I am Nahed Kabbani, and this is The Lighthouse for today's viewers.
Welcome to our show. As we promise our viewers, we always try to seek some knowledge to bring new ideas, to give you some view or some knowledge about some topics you didn't know about it before. Today, our topic, faith. For this matter, we came to CAIR and we met Mr. Hussam, the executive director for CAIR. Let us welcome Mr. Hussam and let him introduce CAIR to us. Welcome, Mr. Hussam, to our show.
Thank you.
Will you please give our viewers an idea about what is CAIR means?
Sure. Well, greetings of peace to you and to your viewers, and that is in Arabic, Assalamu alaikum. May the peace of God be with you all. My name is Hussam Ayloush, and I'm the executive director of CAIR, the Southern California office of CAIR, the Council on American-Islamic Relations. And I've been with this office for about 12 years, and it's a great honor to be addressing your viewers today. CAIR is the Council on American-Islamic Relations. It's based in Washington, D.C. It's the largest Muslim advocacy group in America, with 33 offices across the nation. CAIR's mission is to enhance the understanding of Islam, promote dialogue, protect civil liberties and civil rights for all Americans, and build coalitions that promote mutual understanding and justice across America. We're not a religious organization per se. We do represent the American Muslim community, but our goal is to build bridges with all people of all faith.
What CAIR stands for?
CAIR stands for the Council on American-Islamic Relations.
So that means almost educational center for American people.
It's actually a very American, a bona fide, very genuine American organization that is open to all people of all faith and no faith too. And we do have members who are, obviously many of our members happen to be Muslim, but also we have many supporting members and donors who are Jewish, Christian, Hindus, and others. People who believe in the mission of CAIR, and that is promoting the dialogue and a mutual understanding. And as CAIR's name says, we will counsel on American-Islamic relations. So we'd like to be the bridge that brings all Americans together, but also a better understanding between all Americans and Islam, because we live at a time when, unfortunately, Islam is misunderstood.
Can you give our viewers an idea about Islam in your point of view?
Islam is one of the Abrahamic faith traditions that exist in the world today, one of the three Abrahamic faith, one of the major religions of the world, and that is meaning you have Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. They all trace their roots to Abraham, the patriarch or prophet Abraham, peace be upon him, who Muslims consider to be almost the first father of Islam in that sense. Abraham had two children. He had Ishmael and Isaac, Ismail and Ishaq, as we call them in Arabic, of which the three branches of the Abrahamic faith came from the side of Ismail came Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and he is the prophet who received the revelation of the Quran. And from the side of Isaac came obviously many other prophets, including Moses and Jesus, from whom comes the traditions of Judaism and Christianity. Of course, Islam believes is a very monotheistic religion, believes in the oneness of God. That's probably the core of the Islamic faith, believing in one God, the God of Abraham. In Arabic, we call him Allah, as he's called in English, God, or in French, Dieu, or Spanish, Dios. He is the God of Abraham, the creator of Adam and Eve, the creator of all people, whether they believe in him or not. We believe that God has sent prophets and messengers throughout history, you know, from the time of Adam, going through Noah, Abraham, and as I said, Ishmael.
How many messengers?
Hundreds of thousands. Many of them we know of. Their names were mentioned in the Quran, the Bible. Many of the prophets actually mentioned in the Bible are also mentioned in the Quran, such as David, such as Yunus, Jonah, such as, of course, Solomon, Noah, John the Baptist, Jesus, Muhammad, obviously is mentioned in the Quran, peace be upon him all. So we believe that God sent many prophets, some we know of, some we don't know of, and actually we believe that every nation, God has sent them a messenger to guide them, and the guidance is to know God and live by his teachings. Those teachings are good for us in this life and the hereafter. These are teachings that teach us how to communicate and connect with our Creator, God Almighty Allah, and how to communicate with fellow human beings, our friends, our neighbors, our relatives, our parents, our children, how to treat each other, how to treat friends and how to treat enemies, how to forgive, how to be patient, and how to do good to other people. That is really the essence of every religion. Islam itself, the word Islam comes from the word, it's an Arabic word that comes from the root word salam. Salam means peace. And really the essence of Islam is to bring us peace as human beings. Peace within ourselves, peace with our Creator, and peace with fellow human beings. And actually I would add peace with the whole environment, with the whole creation, meaning animals, environment, the air, the earth, everything. It allows us how to not to take advantage of this environment and this earth. So it's peace. It also means submission. Submission to the will of God. Meaning we as human beings would be willing to put our ego aside and be willing to accept authority and guidance from God. And that is to be able to submit to him rather to our ego and our whims and our selfishness and all of that. Islam also teaches its followers to believe in scriptures. Scriptures that were revealed to all prophets before. Last of the prophets as Muslims believe in is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and his revelation is the Quran. But also Islam teaches us to believe in the scriptures that were revealed early on, such as the Psalms of David, such as the Gospel, the Injil of Jesus, Isa, as we call him in Arabic, or the Torah before that of Moses. So Islam believes that these are revelations from God.
What faith means to the human being?
Faith is a very broad term that from a Muslim perspective it's a little bit different. From a Muslim perspective, faith is not something you do on the weekend alone. It's not something you do when you're away from people and you try to connect with the Creator. Faith is for a Muslim is a way of life. You can't have a double life. You can't say I'm faithful on a Sunday or Friday or Saturday, like some...
Cannot pick and choose.
We cannot pick and choose. Faith is really a way of life. If you say, my faith teaches me to be honest, to be a person of integrity, to be caring, to be compassionate, that means I have to live by that every day of my life, every hour of my life. I can't have... When I go to work, I put faith aside and I start cheating people as a business person. I start mistreating my spouse, my wife, or my children, or my parents. But then I go to church or to the mosque and suddenly I become faithful. So faith is the whole way of life that determine your relationship with God and your relationship with fellow mankind. And you cannot separate. I cannot say I'm faithful to God, but I betray and mistreat fellow human beings. Actually, faith should even impact how you treat animals, how you treat everyone you know.
I believe faith comes to the world to teach us how to do those things, to direct us how to live the life God wanted to be.
I mean, from a Muslim perspective, we believe that the one who created us is God. And as the one who created us, he knows, this being knows what's good for us or what's bad for us. So when he says, do this and avoid this, it is not for his own good, because he does not benefit from me being a good person. He does not benefit, it does not add to his power, whether I'm good to other people or not, whether I'm mean to other people or not. It impacts me and it impacts our society. So yes, faith is about giving us the tools that would make our societies better societies, where all of us would benefit from that society, where the rich and the poor, the black and the white, the Latinos, the Arab, all the people with no faith. Everyone should be able to live with peace of mind, should live with being accepted with his dignity or her dignity. And because at the end of the day, as God says in the Quran, that we have honored all the children of Adam with dignity. So it's not a matter of you don't get this dignity just because you are Christian or Muslim or Jewish or white or black. Or mm-hmm. This dignity is given to you as a birthright the minute you are a human being. And every human being has that right. And this is important. I know it sounds philosophical, but actually it impacts us on a human level, on a political level. Because as we hear talks that dehumanize other people today, whether on in foreign affairs, you know, one group trying to dehumanize the others. We notice that in the Middle East, you know, with attempts to dehumanize the Palestinians nowadays, or in the aftermath of the terrorist attacks of September 11, there are attempts to dehumanize Muslims. Or even in our own country today, where some people try to dehumanize immigrants, or undocumented immigrants, to be specific. It brings us a reminder that we as human beings who believe in God, whether we're Muslim, Christian, Jewish, or others, we have a duty to reaffirm this humanity and this dignity for every human being, no matter how poor they are, how rich they are, legal, undocumented, illegal, whatever the name might be, they're human beings.
That led me to the question of, you mentioned that we're born with the dignity as a gift from God. We're born as completed human being. I believe a person with no dignity, he is not a person, he is not a human being to begin with. To keep that, to treasure that dignity and to keep that image of God, the creation as person with dignity, we have to work on it. And if we lost it, we lost that ability to be human being. That means we have to act as good human being for God to not be able to have this reaction from other people. Humiliation or discrimination or hardship. If the person starts to think of himself not to do mistakes, there is no other people to come against him without any felony or any reason.
Very well said. Actually, that takes us to what's called the golden rule of all religions. Mm-hmm. You know, Christianity has it, Islam has it, and Judaism has it. And actually, even it's present in many other religions, to be exact. Hinduism, I've read it. Buddhism, and that is treat others as you like them to treat you. Really, this is the golden rule of every religion. And if we can all live by it, because the minute I dehumanize others, what I'm doing really, I'm dehumanizing myself. The minute I find reasons to believe or convince others that this person deserves less treatment, less good treatment than I deserve, what I'm saying, I'm legitimizing someone else saying the same thing about me. So It goes back to that aspect of golden rule, and that is, there's a saying of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in which he says, one of you is not a true believer until he or she loves for others what they love for themselves. Anything else, we're faking this belief. You know, the minute I claim faith, I claim believing in God, but I cannot love for others, for my fellow human beings, what I love for myself, I'm not a true human being, I'm not a true believing human being. So I think it's something good that we have to remind ourselves and make that as our driving force, as a guiding principle by which we can live in. Because once we can do this, and when we say that, we have to build it in ourselves. You know, I don't want to sound like a preacher, I'm not a preacher, but once we build this in ourselves, as teachers, as doctors, as engineers, as politicians, as activists, as mothers, as fathers, we build it in ourselves, then we build it in our families, children, spouses, parents, then into our neighborhood, then into our work. Imagine a doctor who's doing his or her job with compassion for, not as a job, just with compassion, a teacher, an engineer, a worker, a politician. Imagine if all of our politicians start looking at their role and their duty as a responsibility, not just as another job or just being able to remain keeping that seat, but actually as a service that is coming from their heart. I think things will be much different in our world.
I always say you can't control the whole world with love and peace,
more than war and weapons.
You're absolutely right. And I think it begins with ourselves. And if each one of us can put those principles where we can say, you know what, it's not an easy task. You know, sometimes when you're wrong, it is natural to feel like I can't forgive, I can't move on. It's going to take an ability to bring a balance of two things, because also we're human beings. You know, we can't just say forgive and there's injustice happening. I think what is needed is always to remember there are two things that are needed. One cannot happen without the other. Justice, then comes peace and forgiveness. If as long as there is injustice, it is very difficult and it's impossible eventually to have a long-term peace and forgiveness, you know, because there's always one side taking advantage of the other. So our job would be to seek that justice with compassion in order to have peace. So it's three components.
You are right. There is a lot of faith is before Judaism and Christianity and Islam, and people believe in that deeply, and they are close to God with different point of view. But at least they believe in something that made them good people, at least for God or for what they believe. Is there any differences between faith and belief?
Belief could be restrained sometimes, without getting too philosophical here, but belief could be an issue of belief in terms of religious aspect. Some would bring faith into that sense too. Usually it has to do with a spiritual ideology, let's call it this way, or a spiritual experience that you have that make you believe in something. It's very similar. Faith and belief is the same. What is a little bit different is probably the word religion in itself. Mm-hmm. Religion takes the level of faith or belief into another level, and that is something organized. A religion has usually a set of rules, something that makes you part of it, or something that could get you out of it. So if you don't believe, for example, in Jesus, whether you believe in him as God, Son of God, Messiah, and so on, if you don't believe in him, you cannot call yourself Christian, for example, in that sense. If you don't believe in Muhammad, you know, peace be upon him too, you cannot call yourself as part of the Muslim religion. So you can say, I have faith in God, I believe in God, I believe there's a God, but you don't have to claim any religion in that sense. So I think it's a technical difference between religion and faith in that sense. But I think for all purposes today, most people would equate both. Because when we talk about Judaism or Islam or Christianity or Hinduism, we call them faith also, as we call them religion.
Stay tuned for more. I remember someday a policeman talking to family for their kids. He was on drug and with the rehab center and things, and the guy doesn't want to stay. So the policeman asked the parents to take the boy to the mosque or church or synagogue, wherever they believe in it as religion. Take this boy to that center, because this center will help that boy more than the rehab center. That to me means there is something in it as a human being to be close to God, understand what is in his faith, and the people who teach him, they put that image in himself and keep him close to God. Lately I heard in the news that CNN does research about faith in America, and that research said 64% have believe in somehow religion, and half of them changed their religion recently somehow to any without name. But the rest of it, they don't believe in anything. They go out of religion totally. So what does that mean, or what pushed a person to disbelieve in his religion or to disbelieve in God to begin with?
I think the poll you're mentioning, I think, is a Pew Research study that was done, over, I think, by polling about 35,000 people. And I think the number we're saying, almost half, about 44% of the adult population in America has or have changed their religion of birth at one point or the other, which is a huge number, probably the largest that exists in the world today. If anything, that tells us about a few things to think about here. One is the information age that we live in today is giving a lot of access to information. In the past, a person was born into a religion and they were always isolated. They wouldn't have access to other knowledge, other religions. Today, with the information age, the internet, cable TV, satellite TV, books, magazines, and the diversity that exists today within America. You can go to any workplace, any school, and you see people of all faith backgrounds. So this openness and this accessibility is allowing people to be exposed to many different religions. And many people are feeling that maybe I'm not reaching the spirituality that I seek or that I would love to have with my own faith group. So many people are trying different things. And some people find it in Islam, some people find it in Judaism. You hear about Christians becoming Buddhists, and so on and so forth. That is the one thing. The second thing is the point of many people saying they're not part of any, or they're not affiliated with any religion, and that is a growing number today in America. So I think, according to the poll, it's about 12% of people in America said they don't belong to any, or they're not affiliated with any religion. They might call themselves, for example, maybe Christian or Jewish or Muslim, but they don't affiliate with any organized effort. They don't go to church, they don't go to anything at all. That number, if anything, is an indication about the growing materialism within our society today, and the pressure of materialism. So many people today don't have regular jobs from 9 to 5. Many people work either two jobs, both parents working maybe. Many people are working from 9 to 9, 8 in the morning to 9 p.m. On the weekends, they're busy with things. We don't have time to seek spirituality. We don't have time to connect with our Creator. So quite often what happens is, slowly, we move away from what is needed. You know, we need food to keep our physical body functional. But we also need spirituality to keep our brains and our hearts insane, as we say. We're not a machine. We don't want to become a machine. We don't want to become a machine that needs oil and fuel to operate. We need more than oil and fuel. We need more than food and drink to operate. But it's an indication of our society today and the growing materialism and the individualism that is happening in society. More and more Americans are feeling less being part of society or community, unfortunately, because of the other factor that I wanted to talk about is the large movement that exists. There's a fast movement. We're a very dynamic and fluid community. Quite often, a majority of Americans today don't live in the same city where they were born in. So the fact that we move a lot, we're on the run. You know, we're reading in metros, in the bus, or as we're driving, some of us. We don't have a free moment.
Fast life like fast food.
Fast life on a fast lane, really. I mean, fast food, we're on the cell phone, so there's no break in our life. Everything is fast. What is happening, and it's quite often people move. You know, every 3 years they're in a different apartment, different condo, different house, different job. Why not different religion? You know, we're always looking. You know, if I try McDonald's today, I don't like it. I go try Burger King, I don't like it. Starbucks, I don't like it. Coffee Bean. We're always trying. There's no inhibition, no fear, and no resistance to change. Say, you know, let me try that. Let me try this dress. Let me try that dress. Let me try this city, this job. In the past, people like stability. They don't like to see change. You know, same family, same neighborhood, same job. Most people will have a job and end up retiring within that job. Today, people are moving, so we see more, fluid aspect of religion too. So people are saying, let me try this denomination, or I don't like it, let me try the other church. And I think we'll see more of that. It has, obviously, the pluses and the minuses. We talk about a lot of the negative aspect of it, the individualism, the growing materialism, so on. But I think the positive aspect is, it's a I think it's a great indication of what America stands for, and that is tolerance. We are a tolerant nation, more so than many other nations. We accept people trying different religions. We accept people studying about other religions. Yeah, we do have extremists and intolerant people, but overall, as a nation, I think we are a nation that accepts differences.
Well, I believe American people in general, as education, they don't have that solid basic education. When you have a lot of knowledge, the way we have it now through technology and people going to buy because they have money and they buy the latest in the market and use it whatever it goes, it become against us because not everything coming with the technology without enough knowledge with the person, in the person mind, it will be good. I think that's why we see a lot of bad things happen all of a sudden. As much as we have all of a sudden too much technology and knowledge, we have too much bad actions from people inside homes and cities and communities.
You know, information and knowledge, I differentiate a little bit, but information itself is a double-edged sword, meaning not having it obviously is or not having enough of it is a sure recipe for failure, as we see in many third world countries, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But also having too much of it ends up doing the same result. Mm-hmm. And they call it overload of information or information overload, where when you start getting too much information or having access to too much information, because there is never too much knowledge, really. We can never reach
access
for it. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of access to information, but what happens, it creates a reaction within us that we block it now because there's way too much and we feel like, where can I begin? You know, there's mm-hmm. way too much, I don't care. Plus, there's a factor, and we as Americans, we do believe we're much better off than most other people. I mean, our view of ourselves is a little bit, I think, exaggerated. In a sense, we do think we know more than other people, because we confuse economic stability and economic success with knowledge. So because we are more than other nations doing well, we're doing much better than many of our neighbors in South America and in Africa and others, neighbors in the world, basically, and Asia and others. But we confuse that. We think that we've reached what we need to know. So we don't feel the urge to learn about the African culture or the Australian people or the Malaysian culture or the Islamic culture, the Arabs or the Palestinians or the Mexicans. And we don't feel there's a need for us to learn about a foreign language. Most people in America speak one language. You go anywhere else in the world, on average, people speak two, many three and four. In Europe, not uncommon for people to know three languages. You go to countries like Lebanon and Palestine and Jordan, and the average person speaks two, maybe three languages. Now, this doesn't mean one nation is better than the other. But what it means is we have some kind of self-fulfillment where we convince ourselves we don't need. So it's a challenge. We have to take that challenge. And those of us who have links to different cultures, people who are immigrants, recent immigrants, people who have interest in reading about other cultures, have a duty to convey that to our fellow Americans and say, listen, you know, there's much more in the world than just being American. There's a lot of good things, great things to learn about from other nations. And then that takes us to another level, and that, you know, the faith issue. We're talking about faith. Today, a lot of the conflict today that are being fueled or pushed are somehow affiliated or linked to religion. I don't think these are religious wars. They're mainly political wars. But what happens, the easiest way to explain a war, you know, we have to say, oh, they fight each other because they're Protestant and Catholic, oh, because they're Sunni and Shia, or because they're Muslim and Jewish. It might not be the real reason, but that's how media would like to explain things, to simplify things. So in order for us to prevent ourselves from being pulled into this, and in order to prevent such wars, the least thing we can do is to understand and learn about other cultures. If all Muslims take the time, Muslims outside of America, take the time to learn about America, the American culture, the American history, and about Christianity, for example. And then, vice versa, we as Americans take the time to learn about the Muslim culture, the Arab world, Southeast Asia, the history of the Middle East. What happens is, chances of war would be more slim, and chances, bridges of understanding would be larger now and bigger. So we have to take the effort to learn about each other, because at the end of the day, it's a small earth, we all live in it, and we all live on it, and we can't afford to have wars based on ignorance and misinformation.
That's the way I believe. I always, when I reach out and talk about things, I mention that God, we have in Quran something about America. We believe, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ
مِنْ
ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. America, the way it built up as a nation from all over the world. The only native American is American.
Mm-hmm.
The rest of the people who made America, America, from outside. And this ayah is, Dr. Ayah Sakhar says, it is on the door of United Nations in English.
Mm.
Also, he was working for 5 years, going inside, outside, under that, ayah. So if we are smart enough, we have to learn from those who become American and what they have as background and roots. We have to seek knowledge from those. Even we have to seek knowledge about the educational system over there and all over the world, why it is better than ours, to learn how to be better in the future. So including too many different faiths and point of views and things, that's what it built America.
Yeah.
We are proud to be American, and we are proud of what we brought to America from our side, from our roots, background. Mm. So America should be, as leaders, they should be smart enough to seek some ideas from here and here to build up new ideas to be leaders also for the whole world.
Absolutely. Anna. Maybe I'll translate the verse that you mentioned.
Yes.
All you who believe, we've created you from a single pair, of a male and a female, Adam and Eve. And we made you, God is saying, I made you into nations and tribes that you may know one another. In the most honored and dignified in the eye of God among you are the one who have more piety towards God and towards fellow human beings.
And he didn't name any religion.
No, it's basically, exactly.
Yes.
Basically, God, what this verse is doing is it's affirming the equality among human beings.
Yeah.
It's, you know, God on purpose created us into nations and tribes. He could have created us all white or brown or green or yellow or any color you would like, but he intentionally, deliberately created us from different nations, different tongues, different languages, different skin colors, so we can learn and appreciate each other and one another. And I want to add, confirming what you said, I think America is a very unique place in a very positive way. It sets a model for the rest of the world.
Absolutely.
And that is that we are able, as a diverse nation, very diverse, probably we are the most diverse nation in the world today. People of different faith backgrounds, Muslim, Christian, Jews, Hindus, Buddhists, atheists, people of different ethnicities, ethnic backgrounds, all nations.
All samples from all the world.
Exactly, have come together,
yes.
And to a great extent succeeded in being one family,
yes.
Succeeded being bonded together as one nation, caring for the same value system, for justice, for equality. We've had our challenges and we continue to have our challenges, and that's what makes life interesting. We continue to have challenges to always accept others, not isolate them and marginalize them and defame them and dehumanize them, but that's part of the challenge. But to a great extent we have succeeded, and we have a model to take to the rest of the world. And you said it correctly, we can learn from the rest of the world too. We have a lot to give to the world, but we also have a lot to take from it. And as one scholar one time said, the minute you hear someone saying, I've achieved, I've attained knowledge, that's the minute you know that this person is ignorant. Because
yes.
You can never contain all the knowledge
yes.
in the world. We can get some of it, and as they say, the more knowledge, as one scholar one time said, the more I learned, the more I realized how little do I know. So I think it's a great attitude to have, to be able to acknowledge, be thankful, very grateful for what God has given us so far, but also acknowledge that there's so much knowledge out there that we can learn from everybody. You know, not they don't have to be a superpower for us to learn from them. They could be a humble nation, a humble individual, and we can still learn and benefit from them too.
Actually, I myself, I'm proud to be American. To become American, to have what I was dreamed to do or to have from America, in America. But I become strongly believe that even this America as a new world is the one God meant to say about it in Quran. That make me closer to believe that America should be blessed from God because it carries all God believers, no matter what they are, and the sample of life, sample of creation from God, which is make us stronger and more knowledge. And as you mentioned, we have to seek
absolutely
better future also.
One World Org, promoting cultural understanding through the media.
Year 2008 is maybe the most important year in history. It carries the election, and it carries in the election two new faces, approach and address two different ways as usual. One of them as a black ethnicity, mm-hmm. and the other woman to be a president. And the fight, it become too much knowledgeable fight, make us not able to follow up how much knowledge in both persons, mm-hmm. and how we choose. Which one we choose? What do you think?
Obviously, you're right. The presidential election this year could bring some historic moments where we could have the first African-American president or the first woman president. Or we can actually go back to the history and have another white Christian male president. And that wouldn't be much different from the history. Either way, whatever happens at the end of the day, it's actually, you're right. It's a very monumental time of our life as Americans, and America is becoming the center of the world today because we're the only superpower nowadays, and what happens in America impacts the rest of the world, and we've seen that in the last 7 years, specifically with the Bush administration and the policies that have actually undermined the stability in the world today, and unfortunately as Americans, as proud as we are in our value system and in our contribution to the world, but also we have some reasons to look upon and realize we have to be more politically active to ensure that we don't become responsible for another war, a war such as the war in Iraq, which has caused the death of over 1 million Iraqis, many more than what Saddam Hussein, with all his brutality, could have caused himself.
About refugee?
Yeah, the millions of the refugees and the millions and millions of people who have lost family members, millions of children who are today orphans, the million of widows who have lost their breadwinners. We have generations of Iraqis now who would live in misery, in unfortunate and anger and frustration and maybe even hatred. Unfortunately, this war has managed to create more enemies and more instability in the world than any regime or any Al-Qaeda extremist could have ever done. And this is something we have to deal with, and we as human beings are responsible for it, and more so as Americans. So that takes us back to the election and the importance of election, and how many US dollars have been spent on wars, on illegal wars, and this money does not come from the sky. This money comes from programs that were supposed to be helping us Americans, helping the needy in America, helping the uninsured in America. Today we have close to 50 million Americans who don't have access to medical health care, medical care because they can't afford it. They can't have access to doctors and hospitals for their own children. Our educational level and system is suffering today. I just came back from a meeting in LA, in the city of LA, and the mayor's office, were complaining about one of our largest deficits. You know, it's a shame that a city like LA can suffer from a $200-300 million deficit when we're spending literally tens of billions of dollars every month on wars that have actually no benefit to anyone in the world, except for the oil companies and some defense contractors. So the election is extremely important. And America has changed. I think for the first time in our history, recent history, we have very viable candidates. One is woman and another one is African-American. And both, actually are bringing a lot of energy to the campaign. Both are campaigning on change because people want to see change in America. They want to see change outside of America. I think it's very positive, regardless of which candidate a person supports, which candidate your viewers support. Just the fact that we're having viable candidates today who belong to a minority is also hopeful. By the way, this is unfortunately a little bit late in a sense compared to other countries that had women as prime minister and presidents. We've seen
the third world
happen. The third world countries, you know, from Indonesia to Pakistan to Bangladesh to many countries in Africa, even the UK, which is not a third world country, but even the UK have had Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher and others. So I'm glad we're catching up with them on that sense, and I hope we will send the message that you can belong to a minority and still win, regardless of how you stand on their politics. For me, it's also in itself a message that we should hopefully benefit from in that sense.
As minorities, as immigrants built up America, lead me to ask you about we as Americans, we cannot live happily if our relatives or parents or other side of our families around the world, no matter what color or race or religion person who are, we are American here. We belong to America and American rules, and to be a good American citizen, we have to be able to do, to work with capacity, work with honesty, work with good feeling, while we are suffering about the other side of the world, where is the person roots come from, they are get killed or suffering low food, no, with level of, below level of poverty, and we are here continue having the same course or the same image about fighting here, doing war here, create jobs from war, forgetting that when our military come back, have no leg, no hand, suffering from
stress
and the images of the war. They cannot live happily again. That means we lost them while they are still alive, and costly more than imagination for later also for this human being. What do you think about thinking of American, but don't think about the roots or the the relative or the people, how much they suffer from that emotional and stress?
Well, the late Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King said, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. So we cannot live in isolation. We don't live like the old days, maybe 3-4 centuries ago, in an isolated island, as we at least figure of speech thought we did, meaning what happens in Africa does not concern me, or what happens in Europe does not concern me. We learned it early on, and especially in World War II, that what happens in other parts of the world impact us. World War II, we thought, you know, that's why we were late getting involved in stopping the Nazis or the imperialist Japan, because we thought we don't need to worry about it. And suddenly we saw what the Nazi Germany or Nazi German army was doing to Europeans, or what it was doing to French people, to the Jewish people, to Polish people, and we felt it didn't concern us. And we saw what Japan was doing to neighboring countries, and the Philippines and China and so on. Eventually we saw that it came back to us. So that history is learned. Today, we have many, many responsibilities, many moral responsibilities. One of them is the fact that we are a country that is well off, a country that has resources that others don't have. We do waste resources more than any other country and nation in the world. So we have that moral responsibility. And I think we're fortunate enough also that we have so many Americans who have still links to many other countries in the world. So they can help us open the doors for us, really open the doors to us, so we can help in other nations. So if there's an earthquake in Pakistan, if there's a tsunami in Indonesia, or there's a war in Palestine, if there's a war in Kosovo, if there's a possible war in Kenya, if there's a genocide in Rwanda, There's instability in Sudan. Any place in the world, there's instability in Mexico, poverty in Mexico. So whatever you look at, we are fortunate enough that we have people who understand that culture and they actually still have links to those nations and those cultures. They will help us be part of the solution, whether on a political level, governmental level, where they can guide our government. So the aid that we distribute every year, instead of spending that aid into military aid to give F-16s and Apache helicopters to some countries to attack and bomb cities and innocent people, maybe we can direct that aid. And we already do some of that, so increase that aid to those areas where there's a need. So we can do that on a governmental level. But throughout history, our biggest aid came from the American people themselves, through various nonprofit organizations, relief organizations that exist, the Red Cross, various Catholic charities, and Islamic Relief, and so many other Islamic, Christian, Jewish, secular organizations that exist. We need such people to open the doors, and we should never feel ashamed of our heritage, because again, we are a nation of immigrants, and all of us have to have a sense of pride of that link, not in a nationalistic or tribal way, but actually in an enrichment way. I can come back and say, hey, you know, I'm Irish, I'm Italian, I'm Greek, I'm Muslim, I'm Jewish, and I can bring the richness and the depth of that culture, the politics, the arts, the everything else, and bring it into America. And the same way, take back from us Americans the great resources, the great blessings that God has blessed us with, and give back to people who are in need, less fortunate than us.
You mentioned a great point, especially as America, we lead the world with human rights. So we are the leaders for human rights. We should look at the whole world from the point of view for human rights. We cannot ignore that, and we cannot kill in one hand and give on the other hand and name ourselves as heroes or givers.
Yeah, I wish I can agree with you. We used to lead the world in human rights. Now we lead the world in talking about human rights. But actually, as you're alluding to and referring to, we are not leading anymore. We're not the role model, actually. We speak about it. We say, do as I say, but don't do as I do. We're actually giving a bad example in human rights. I can list a few examples. The way we treat immigrants, and specifically the way we treated Muslims in America after September 11th, as government and as different agencies. Guantanamo Bay, where we held hundreds of people who were never charged with anything, hundreds of accused people for years and years, away from their families, away from their children, away from their parents, without ever giving them a day in court. If someone is guilty of terrorism, by all means, punish them to the full extent of the law, because I don't think anybody would have any sympathy for someone who engages in terrorism against innocent people, whether you're a Muslim, Christian, or any person. You don't have to be an American to abhor and condemn such behavior. But also, we have to give due process. We can't say, because we think you're a terrorist, we're going to punish you without giving them a day in court. They have to have their day in court, and we haven't done so yet. The rendition program that exists today, where the CIA would arrest people without trial, will kidnap people, actually, without due process, kidnap them from different parts of the world and send them to countries that have absolutely no respect for human rights, where they get tortured, where we use torture against them in order to get confessions under duress, under torture, under force. We get confessions, so what? So we can say, look, we got these confessions. The waterboarding, which our government has proudly spoken about as if it's not a form of torture, where people are put under the water. The way we have engaged in abuse in various prison systems, in Abu Ghraib, in Iraq, the way we've allowed ourselves to occupy other nations, the way we support governments all over the world today that are known to be violators of human rights. I think, unfortunately, today we're not leading by example. This is not what America stands for. And I have no doubt on my mind, if we put this on vote, and we ask Americans to vote whether we want to abide by human rights or not, overwhelmingly, everybody would say we want to. But most of us are being led today by the policies of fear, fear of everything that is different. Today, under the name of fighting terrorism, our government is trying to convince us, out of fear, that everything is legitimate. Every tool is acceptable in that war, and it's not. If we legitimize human rights violations against other people, what would stop other people from violating those same rights against us the next time we are arrested or detained somewhere? The next time I'm traveling as an American, any part of the world, if I get detained, what will protect me as a human being, and especially as an American? Because their argument, whoever will kidnap or kill or torture, would be, well, that's what you do. We lose this leverage and we lose the credibility of influencing other countries. If we're trying to influence the human rights records of Russia or China or even North Korea, what face do we have to go and tell North Korea, don't abuse human rights, don't violate human rights, when we are well known to do it? So America, we have a role to play, and that is, that role is to go back to our values and hold those who break those values and those principles accountable for what they've done. And thank you for bringing up this very important question.
Back to election time, what is in your mind as maybe American Muslim? What party will be good, or what the future, what are you looking for the future president?
Maybe before I answer this, I want to say we talked about how we've seen history in recent months about first black candidate, well, actually the first viable black candidate and first viable woman candidate in our history. It's probably important to note that actually last year, in 2006, so 2 years ago, we've witnessed another history being made in Congress, the election of the first American Muslim member of Congress, Congressman Keith Ellison from the state of Minnesota. That is history, and actually in a few weeks we might be witnessing another follow-up to that, and that is the election of a second Muslim member of Congress, and that is candidate Andre Carson from Indiana. So America is changing, and America is becoming more diverse and more accepting. As for us Muslims, unfortunately we've seen faith being brought into the election today, not in a positive way, but actually a negative way. We've heard comments made by various candidates, or past candidates. Candidate Romney saying if he is elected, he wouldn't appoint a Muslim to his cabinet because there aren't enough Muslims in America. And mind you, he's Mormon, and there are probably almost as many Mormons as Muslims in America. Yet, I mean, he felt it's okay for a Mormon to be president, but not enough. There aren't enough Muslims to serve in his cabinet. To his credit, he later on apologized for that comment. We've heard Mr. McCain saying he'd rather vote for a Christian president. We've seen Giuliani appointing advisors such as Congressman King from New York saying there are too many mosques in America. We've seen candidate U.S. Senator basically Obama being attacked for his middle name, which is Hussein Obama, and made accusations against him for being supposedly some hidden closet Muslim, which he denies and says I was never a Muslim and I was he belongs to a Christian church. Obviously, for some Muslims, many Muslims feel that as much as they look, many Muslims actually today, I think, see in Senator Obama as a sign of hope and change for America, because many of the policies of the past administration had been heavy-handed on the world, creating more tension domestically and internationally. So many people are, like many Americans, are looking for change, and many, if you ask around, many Muslims
young
are,
energy.
There's
young,
a lot of young energy that hopefully will bring America back on the right track, as people would say, and so on. But also, if you talk to many Muslims, many are disappointed by the fact that when he was attacked for being supposedly a secret Muslim, his response was not, well, you know, his response, no, I was never a Muslim, you know, that's a lie, and I'm a Christian, all of that. And that's fine, it's his choice, you know, why would I care what his choice is? What Muslims feel is that he should have said, while I'm not a Muslim, I respect Islam and Muslims. I have all respect, you know, my family from my dad's side, many of them are Muslim, or most of them are Muslim, and I have nothing but respect for Muslims, and everybody who chooses to be Muslim or otherwise, should be respected for
but
their choice.
But I'm not
a Muslim.
I
unfortunately, he didn't do that, and many Muslims you repeat that and say, had he said that, actually he would at least challenge Islamophobia, mm-hmm. because really it's an Islamophobia attempt tactic to basically they're saying he's Muslim, that's why he's not a good candidate. And then there was the famous image of him wearing some traditional Somali mm-hmm. dress, mm-hmm. where they're saying he's wearing some Islamic mm-hmm. dress, as if there is an Islamic dress. You know, these are ignorant comments made by people who have never been to Africa, obviously, because Africa, which is almost half Christian, that's the traditional dress of Africa.
Since we talk about we don't like war, we don't need war, Mr. Bakir is coming to continue the same procedure or the same duty, which is we have been in that hard life for 8 years. And the only way to go out of that course to go to the Democrat side. But also, I don't see the fight is helping the Democrat side. I see it become weak, not strong. Mm. If the Democrats smart enough, they put hands together and put the goodwill from both sides, because both are high quality people, both. You cannot, that's why they are still the same level. Mm-hmm. Nobody, get step ahead more than the other. So it will be difficult for voters mm-hmm. to choose, and difficult to lose while for the other. If they put hands together and have it one ticket as Democrat to be stronger, powerful, to kick the other party out, otherwise they cannot do. If they put hands together and leave this time for Hillary Clinton as experienced woman, as minority also, because we talk about women rights mm-hmm. for the whole world, but we don't do it.
Yeah.
Give the chance for women to show the whole world that we are in it, we mean what we talk about, and keep Obama as vice president. Next time, Obama will be more experienced person, more mature as a president, and he will take it easy, and he will become president, and Democrat will control for longer years if they did it wisely.
Yeah.
And we all will be winners because we focus on this president, this vice president, without fighting who is this. So they will give us a chance to vote with happiness and mature.
So I take it you're rooting for the woman candidate.
As a woman, yes.
Of course. I would say...
We need a good heart as...
I definitely agree with you. I think we need a candidate or a president today that has compassion. That has a feeling for the impact of war. Somebody who realizes that war is not a video game.
No.
War makes a lot of people lose their lives, their livelihood, their well-being, their separates family. And I think no one better than a mother...
Yes.
Can feel that, but this is not to say I endorse any of the candidates.
An idea, not because...
In general,
a smart person to be voting or smart candidates mm-hmm. to do better for the country or for themselves, because it's not the chair, it's how they will serve.
In general, I would say we need as many women running for office as possible at all levels, because I do see the difference in general. Of course, we've had bad women and we've had good men, so...
Even for one term, 4 years, Obama has a chance to be two years. So the control from Democrat will be longer years.
But let me get back to your question on that sense. Well, first of all, let me make sure that I clarify that as a person who works for a non-profit organization, we do not endorse any specific candidates, and we don't have a stand or a stance or a position on any of the candidates. I can speak personally from my own perspective. I do see the nature of election in America is that the primaries tend to be very competitive. And I think it is good because it allows the best candidate to surface up. And we've seen that among the Republicans. All of them were good charismatic speakers, etc. But at the end of the day, one stood out more than the others. I think it is okay to watch what happens with the Democrats now. Let the one who has most skills and knowledge and experience and solutions stand out, and then they can decide who would be representing their party, and hopefully will have a nice, competitive, good campaign and good race among the Republican candidate nominee and the Democratic nominee, and let the American people choose the one who would bring, hopefully, peace, will bring change, and will bring unity and harmony to America and outside of America.
Actually, we enjoy that time with you, and we got a lot of knowledge today. And on behalf of my viewers, I thank you, Mr. Hussam.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for
your
time.
You're welcome. And on behalf of my guest, I thank you, my viewers, and we'll see you next time.